This podcast episode is brought to you by nothing.
Try it for free.
So, you've written three books?
Yeah, so far.
You've written three books so far.
Yeah.
And how is that? What is that like?
Well, the first book, I was just more or less, I really wanted to publish a book. And so I just collected all these stories that I did and wrote a couple new ones.
Yeah.
And then the process of figuring out how to, because it's self-published.
Mm-hmm.
And that is more or less sometimes a scam, because some self-publishers try to squeeze all the money out of you just to publish a book that you're probably not going to make a whole lot of money off of.
Yeah.
So I found a free self-publishing site.
Yeah.
And which they all frown upon because they're not making money.
All the publishing sites are frowned upon?
No, the self-publishing companies frown upon the free publishing sites. Because they're not making any, they're not getting your money.
All right, right.
So I use CreateSpace.com, which is an affiliate with Amazon.
Mm-hmm.
And sure, there's you'd be charged things, but like you'd have to like just pick everything free, and then they give you an ISBN code for free, and I had to learn all that kind of hard.
Yeah.
I went and bought an ISBN code.
Mm-hmm.
The only problem is if. It does. If you buy a faulty one, you can't get a refund back.
Wow.
So you just,
wow.
I bought one and it wasn't usable.
Yeah.
And it was like I was out $200-something for this piece of information, this data. It's just nothing.
So the ISB encode is the numbers in the back of the book?
Yeah, it's the little, this.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Let me see it.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Yeah. That.
I see. So you can buy a faulty one. Meaning that it's fraudulent, like it's fake?
Well, what happens is it may be, because it's you're buying them online, it may be like, it may not be faulty when you buy it, but you and another person may buy it at the same time, and they may use it faster than you do, and then,
oh, wow.
Then you just don't have a number that's right, or the information gets lost and everything. And this actually, the people that you buy it from, it's all in there. Like, I read the terms of use thing, and it's in there that this may happen, and they're not subject to it. They make you, like, click a little I agree form. Wow.
So what do you do in that case? Does that mean that you have to recall your books if you put them on your books?
No, it doesn't even go in the books. Like, they don't even recognize it. It's not recognizable because the self-publishing site will be like, you don't have an ISBN code. You need an ISBN code. I'm like, I have an ISBN code. So what I did was the self-publishing site, they produce their own ISBN codes. And so you can get it for free. It just means that like your rights, like this isn't just my book. It's their book too. It's like they have some of the rights.
So you publish the book, you write the book, and then like you upload it or something?
Yeah, you have to transcribe it. Like, well, I write longhand, so it's all written out first, and then I have to transcribe it to the computer, then I upload it.
So why do you write longhand?
It feels like the words are alive. Like they're just living because and it's slower. So it gives me more time to think about the story or whatever I'm actually writing.
Yeah, I feel the same way about writing things down with your hand. Like, almost as if there's some thing that we don't fully understand about the process of writing something down with your hand.
Yeah.
Like some sort of a brain motor skill connection that, like, makes you process things differently. You know, maybe, I don't know if you find typing to be the same way. Like, you use that motor skill, or if it messes up your writing because it's too fast, or...
I have an old typewriter from the 40s that I'll type on. So it's not fast at all.
But you're just being a hipster with that, though, right?
No. I found that in the trash and repaired it.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Kind of brings inspiration. I really don't really write anything with it because it's actually way slower than writing.
Yeah. So. Wow.
I don't.
Yeah, I can imagine.
It's like
ching, whoosh, the paper gets stuck or something.
Well, right. Yeah. Then there's like the biggest issue with that is the ribbon, the ink ribbon, because it's still like the original ink ribbon.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been a little too lazy to go get new ones. Yeah.
So it's very faded.
Yeah, very faded there's parts that have holes in them, and I have to like roll it down a little further so I can use the parts that I don't have.
So you've written 3 books so far.
Yeah.
You know, that's impressive because I'm going to tell you right now, I haven't read your books, but I want to read them, you know, but I have a queue.
Yeah.
I'm trying to get through. And it's like, I'll be done with my queue like in, I don't know, 2020. I'm just kidding. No, it's, you know, reading takes so much time and there's so much to read out there.
Yeah.
You know, I go, especially going online, it's almost kind of useless to have access to everything. It's almost like having access to nothing.
Yeah.
Because you can't possibly read all this material. And it's like, oh, look at all this great stuff that you can read. But when can you do that? You have other things to do in life too, you know.
Oh, well, yeah.
You know, but you've written 3 books, and not everybody's written a book. Like, I think, like, maybe 0.5% of the population has written a book in the United States,
yeah,
or less, you know? So how did you do that, man? How did you achieve it? How did you bring it together? Because I wanted to write a book before, and I know people who wanted to write a book, and they just can't put it together. Like, they just can't.
Well, you know. The first book is just a book of like short stories and poems and other writings. And like one of the short stories was a paper I did for an English class, but it was the original story. And I write poems because I used to do spoken word when I was younger. I mean, like 5 or 8 years ago, which isn't terribly young.
Spoken word, like. Like when people were going, when it was in style to go, and I was walking down the street, and the lady said to me, "That's nacho cheese."
Not like that, but sort of like, well, no, it's spoken word, being like you have a piece of work, and you go out to like an open mic or something, and then you do the piece, but not so much beatnik where they're all snapping and everything, or like hipsterish and cool and like, oh, I'm so cool. And it wasn't really that at all. I just went up and I was like, I need to, because I'm a real nervous person. So it's like to conquer my fear of public talking.
Yeah.
Which is, that's really great, really weird, because just I've done so many professions where I'm doing performances and everything, live performances in front of people.
Yeah.
And I'm terrified. So the way I deal with it is by going on stage and doing it anyways.
Yeah, wow.
And it just makes me...
Yeah, man, that's fantastic.
Yeah.
You know? No, you know, it's a courageous thing to do, especially, you know, you're facing your fear.
Yeah.
You know, I was painfully shy when I was in high school. You know, unless you got to know me, I was like 2 different people. Because if I knew you well, I was just crazy. I was like this crazy dude. Like, you know, but if you didn't know me, I was just very shy and didn't say much. And I threw myself into waiting tables, which is a horrible situation to be in. You know, if you have social anxiety and people are demanding food from you and they're already at a disposition to where a lot of the time, the kind of restaurant that I was working at, they already expect you to fuck things up.
Yeah.
You know, so... So you did that and you threw yourself into public speaking.
Like, yeah, getting out in there. And
yeah, man. And so what was that like? How'd that go?
That was, well, I didn't think it went well, but apparently it would always do go well because people would come up to me and talk to me like, oh, this is so great. And like, I really like enjoy your stories and you're an incredible writer. And I think that's one of the reasons why I was like, well, the reason why I started the first book in general is because I just had so many people come up and tell me like, you inspire me, and all these like, well, I guess I can write a book and inspire a lot more people.
Yeah.
And then, but it's not a book about inspiration at all. It's just like a collection of just stuff. But it's like fables, or like a book of fables is
so
not
what's
a collection.
Your, what's your favorite kind of stories, if you have one right now?
A favorite genre? I don't really have genres. I kind of just... my favorite story right now is the one I'm writing.
Yeah,
I'm writing an adventure novel. So, yeah, so.
Adventure. It takes place on the high seas.
Well,
you know why I'm guessing that, right?
Yeah, I know. Sort
of. Donovan King spent like a month or three on a ship.
Yeah, 3 months.
Yeah,
I lived on a boat for a while.
Yeah, with sails and pirates on it.
sailed up the East Coast. And doing theater production.
Yeah, wait. What kind of boat was it?
It was a tall ship. It's a it's designed after a Thames River barge.
Yeah.
Which it's like has a 4-foot draw, which means it's how deep it sits in the water. Mm-hmm.
I'll translate this all this stuff for you.
Yeah. Okay.
It's a pirate. It's a 4-foot draw.
it's a
90- what was the name of it again?
It's the Amara Z.
The Amara Z. 4-foot barge.
And a complement of 20 people, which means that's how many people can live on it, or how many cabins, like how many
little 20 cables. Mateys per cabin. 20 mateys, 20 cabins.
And it's an art ship, a theater ship.
Yeah.
The captain.
So it's a theater ship, meaning that it you go around to different ports and you dock, and then a stage pops down from the ship, and then people go there.
Sort of. that's actually probably the closest description I've heard so far.
All right, cool.
So, it's the deck. We have a truss that we put on the mast, which is like a second floor. And it can hold a lot of people, and it's really, really heavy, so it takes a lot of us to just pull it up and bolt it down, and it just sits there, and it's like the deck is the first stage, and the truss is the second stage.
Okay.
And so...
But the truss is a pole?
No, the truss is the platform that sits on the pole, which is the mast.
Okay, the pirate in me knows that. The truss is the platform. Sits on the pole and the mast.
And, they're actually on tour right now. They're,
I wonder how many people who are on ships have just got on their nerves. We like, hate that shit. We hate that shit. It's so old. Yeah. So that's amazing, man. So you go and you did that for what? For 3 months?
About 3 months, yeah. I worked with them for 2 months prior before them leaving. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't officially a part of their crew.
Mm-hmm.
And I helped them out.
So you stowed away. You stowed away on their ship.
Sort of. And it was ended up too working. Late. Ended up working for them. So, yeah.
Very cool. Yeah, man. So what was that like? It looked like a pirate ship?
Yeah, it was, it's just like the whole, everything about it. I would suggest anyone that's really interested in the style of the ship is to look up the Thames River Barge, because...
The Thames River Barge.
It's like a Dutch vessel, and it's like, the cool thing about...
I like it, I dig it,
The cool thing about those Dutch vessels is, like, they'd, they go down the river, and every time they went to a bridge, it would... they'd have it be able to lower the mast and then raise back up again, which is like a 30-minute process. Mm. We have to have a whole crew up in the front cranking this huge gear and blah, 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 throwing it down and popping it back up. And it's just insane. And it was all on the boat. And it's like this whole setup. And we never did that because we never had to.
Yeah, who started that?
Okay. I don't know. It's an old thing. I don't know. There's probably a whole bunch of
history. So it's like a carnival on water.
Yeah.
Like carnies just traveling all over from port to port.
Circus folk. I want to go
circus folk. Circus folk, I mean. Yeah. Carnival.
Yeah, so.
Ex-cons.
And it was the... it's like an international
people who
crew,
owe taxes.
So.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, let's not talk about that. So you did that, and this book that you're working on is not about being on a ship.
It's not about being on that ship or being... It's not about that experience at all.
Mm-hmm.
And I... Because if I had to write about that experience, I'd have to need all these permissions. And I wanted to originally, but the captain wasn't very fond of the idea. And then he had very good reasoning behind it.
Just change the names of everything.
Yeah.
Change the name of the ship, change the name of the captain.
But then it kind of loses the story for me. Yeah. So I decided to write something that's like a...
What's in the name? A rose is a rose by any other name.
It's a smell.
Yeah. A rose.
Yeah, but no, it's just... it's
so
inspired.
Yeah,
by
you
it.
Don't have to do that. Okay, so so it does take place. The new story does take place over the water.
It has some sense. Mm. It has some agreeable sense to it. So.
And do any of your other? I noticed looking at one of them here. The this one a
8-year,
8-year. That one has samurai swords on the cover. No knives.
Swords.
There's
yeah.
Knives. Are there no? They're swords.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
And I couldn't make it out right away. And there is a guy on, or a girl. Is that a guy? It's a guy in a robe. It's you in a robe.
Yeah.
And you're holding stones in your hand. Is that stones?
It's eggs and
let me hold it up.
Snail shells.
Oh, I see. Okay, yeah. Cool. Yeah. Eggs and snail shells. Okay.
Yeah. Actually, each element of the cover has to do with separate stories in the book.
Okay, cool.
So, it kind of brings it about.
So, what's some of your favorite writing? Like, or people that you like as writers?
Oh, it's been so long since I've read anyone's.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. I tend to, I know some local writers, and I try to read their books, and I had one of the local writers, I know she had the same stage fright, issues with stage fright that I had. But I obviously, it looks like I'm conquering my fear every time. So she wanted me to read her books. That's the only time I read her book, really, is to find the something to read on stage for her to promote her book. And I did that for a couple years back. And her writing was pretty interesting. I need to really read that book because it's more of a fairy tale style.
So you haven't read books because... I notice this happens to musicians too.
Yeah.
But you stopped listening to music because you're playing music all the time. And is that why you haven't read? Is that why? Because you're.
Somewhat. I like to read mechanical transcripts.
Okay. Yeah. Why?
Because I find them interesting. I like to study and research all these things. And I'm really interested in engineering. So it's to me, it's.
What exactly is a mechanical transcript? A manual? No.
Like a manual. Car manual or a manual for a plane or anything like that.
And you like them with graphics on there where it shows you how everything's being put together?
Sometimes, and sometimes I'm okay with just words because I like to imagine what's going on.
The closest thing I've read recently to a technical manual, is that what you call it?
Technical transcript.
Technical transcript is. Achilles' Revenge. No, Achilles' Revenge. Archimedes' Revenge. Mm. And it's about mathematics. And I was pretty interested in reading it, but somewhere, past the halfway point of the book, I was I don't care.
I'm sure they got it's dense or something.
It's just, if you're into math, it's great.
Yeah.
And some of the stories behind the discovery of mathematical equations and the people who discovered them and all these different, even to modern day, things that have happened in mathematics. You know, that's interesting, but the abstract part of the shape of an egg and the strength of it and why it's that strong, I'm like, I don't really care, I just want to eat it.
It's funny as you say that. I've had the whole imagined the whole structure and everything in my head. Oh, it's because of this and all the equations.
Yeah, you could see. I could geometrically see the reasons too why it would be strong. People, I think, are innately geometrists.
Yeah.
Because you know how to hold yourself up to lift something on your shoulders.
Yeah.
So you know what kind of shape through your physiology, what kind of shape to make your body in.
Yeah.
If something's going to fall on you or if you're going to throw something,
I have a term for that. And I apply this term to a lot of things. It's called grandma's cooking. As you don't use a measuring cup for cooking. It's I call it grandma cooking. Because you know how to cook it, and it comes out delicious, but it doesn't actually have any mathematical properties.
Yeah, that's
at all.
What it is, man. It's like grandma's cooking. Like yeah. you just you free ball it, you freestyle.
Yeah.
In a way, or you just do it through intuition.
Yeah.
You know, you intuitively know these things. So you're reading technical manuals, and then so are your books. Are they technical manuals?
No, there's like. There's one equation in my first book that I wrote, and but it's nonsense. It's complete. I don't know.
On purpose?
Yeah, I wrote it because it's called the variable formula for perpetual energy power plant theory. And when I read it, it just makes no sense.
Wait, read that to me again.
It's a variable. Formula perpetual energy power plant theory. Like, here's, you could probably see the whole thing page okay. there.
Yeah, variable formula perpetual.
And it just.
Wait, and, let me see that thing. Let me read it again.
Yeah.
Because I can't remember what you just said. Variable formula for perpetual energy power plant theory. Okay, so it's a formula that's varying for perpetual energy, which means eternal energy.
Yeah.
Like, and then it's a power plant to do this in varying ways.
And it's just a theory.
So if an atom bomb, or if we go to, you know, there's a world cataclysm and somebody mm-hmm. finds this page, they're going to think that we knew this, and then they're going to figure out, like, decades later that we didn't know that and they wasted their time.
Yeah, probably. Well, it says in the very end, it says, just an idea to nullify an argument between two drunk friends. It was pretty
That's
much
good.
Yeah, it was pretty, and I remember writing that down and having two friends just having an argument, and they're just so drunk, and I'm just like, I'm tired of this, and I'm like, you guys are great friends, why are you arguing about something so stupid? I don't even remember what the argument was about.
Mm-hmm.
But I was like, oh no, it was about this, it was about perpetual theory and how that, like, and when I wrote it out, I showed them both. It's like, this is exactly what you're arguing about, and you're both right, and you're both wrong. and there. And then they're like, oh, okay. And I folded it up and put it in my pocket. And I found it years later when I wrote this book. I was like, oh, I'll just put that in there.
Yeah. Yeah, cool, man.
So.
I like that. I like stuff like that.
Yeah.
I would look at that and don't tell anybody. Anybody that doesn't watch this podcast, they won't know. It'll take a mathematician to be like, watch, you actually invented something there.
Well, it's interesting because the book is 8 years grammatically incorrect, and the book is filled with grammatical and like errors, and that was the point mm-hmm. of this book. Also, is not just, it was more of a stab at all the English teachers. Like, I can't publish something that has all these wrong things in it. And at the same time, I was like, and I've had a.
How long ago did you publish that book?
This was 2 years ago.
And that one is called?
And this one's called 8 Year.
8 Year, okay.
And 8 Year. These two I wrote last year, or published last year, and this one's called A Thinker's Paradise, A Sense of Doubt, which is mm-hmm. a raw thought, like stream of consciousness.
Mm-hmm.
I don't even know what I wrote in this. And this one took me 3 weeks to write and publish and illustrate and all like that, which is, I just wanted to see mm-hmm. how to do it. It's Unknown Volley.
Yeah, that one has illustrations in it.
Yeah, it has illustrations in it. And it's
this. Hold it up again. Unknown Volley? Okay, yeah, cool.
This one's a little grim.
What is that on the front right there? Somebody's knee?
That's actually a skull.
Oh, it's a skull.
Yeah, the whole book's about this human skull that yeah. someone sent to me.
Wow.
In the mail.
From a pirate ship.
No, it was a fan.
Oh, wow.
A fan of mine sent me this skull, and they're like, yeah, it's a medical skull. And I had yeah. a couple people say, yeah, this is a medical skull, but this is really young. And
I think those are expensive, man.
Yeah, they are. Skulls. But I just, there's the...
Can I see some of the illustrations on there?
Yeah, here.
So the first one that you have, you named it a ear.
A ear.
Why'd you name it that?
Because that's the name of the last writing.
Okay.
It's actually named that.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a five-part piece that that just kind of, yeah, it's mm-hmm. hard to describe. It's more like it's one of those.
We need a concise answer, Mr. King.
Okay, let me go in.
What are you gonna do? No, I'm just kidding. I'm kidding. What are you gonna do about your name though? Because Steven has got it sewed up.
Oh, it's Steven Mr. Donovan P. King.
Donovan P. King?
Donovan P. King. If anyone goes on...
Now there are people who are going to think you're Chinese. Like nah. Peking duck?
Well, if you go on like Amazon and
yeah. Look, oh, yeah.
Mr. Donovan P. Yeah. King, my books pop up. If you
and
Google
are
it,
these
it
books
pops
for
up.
Sale at Chamblin's?
They're at sale. Yeah, they're in sale at Chamblin's. Okay, and cool.
I
want to
see this
online.
One too over here.
Yeah.
So let me ask you. Can I ask you if you don't mind? You don't have to answer, but
yeah.
How much does it cost to publish a book like this? Like for somebody that wants to publish a book. Like, I'm not saying that I want to publish a book. Maybe I'll publish a book. I don't know.
Well, you said that earlier, but...
Yeah. I'm a musician, man. It's my top priority. And
yeah.
You know, so...
Well, it's this... All these books, like, when I got past the ISBN code and all like that, it's free. It's, all of it's free. It's free to publish... Sorry.
It's okay.
It's free to publish the... When someone buys your book online, they take all the fees out of your cost.
Oh, I see.
So, like, it's better for the writer or for me, essentially, to, like, buy all my books at the cost of printing and then sell them on the streets, and because I'll get the maximum.
It's better for you to do that?
Yeah, because...
Okay, because but, this way, how much are they taking? Like, 60%?
This way, more? They take, like, yeah, I get maybe, like, 25% royalty or something, yeah. 20%.
So they take all that?
They take bastards. 80%. But that's also, that's has to do with
the new
marketing,
the,
like everything. Yeah, they're
so
like...
So what? The marketing, what is that? Like,
well,
it doesn't
it's not,
matter.
It's
it doesn't
not
work.
Just, it's not marketing, really. It's yeah. more like...
people have access to you through their
access.
Store.
And they're accessed, it's... But they also, like, it's a worldwide access. It's all these, it's just store. It's also, they have access in libraries. They have all these other stores gain access because yeah. the books, the Chamblin's don't buy it from Amazon. They buy it from eGram, I think it's called.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, like, where a lot of bookstores buy their books. And they go to this store, and that's where they get, like, all these. So there's all these different... jobs, things that people do that have to do with my book,
mm-hmm.
and they all have to get paid like a nickel or a dime a piece. And since they have to pay all these people like a nickel or a dime, it comes out to this much for just one book. And
yeah, but I'm skeptical when it comes to that.
Oh,
and meaning that. What are you saying?
I researched the hell out of it.
Like
into it.
Like okay, so they have to publish it. They have to get the materials for it.
Yeah.
And they have to have the ink and the papers.
Well, the ink and paper is only like $2 and something cents. It's just okay. flat rate
yeah.
fee for all.
Then somebody has to set it.
Yeah.
Like on the printer. If they do, I don't know. Technology is amazing.
I'm sure like this doesn't look like.
So that's like what? Five people so far?
Yeah, they have to
I'm
take,
talking about like I know what I'm talking about.
They have to take the. Well, see, it's. So they have the person that cuts the paper and the person that puts the ink in.
Oh, that's
in.
Not a person anymore.
I know.
No, I don't know. I'm just making
then,
stuff up.
And then they bind the spine,
mm-hmm.
but that's before they put the cover on.
Okay.
And then they have a person that's focused on just putting the cover on.
And what language do these people speak?
They're from all over the world, and they all speak... The ancient language of stuff.
Exactly. Slave labor. 14-year-old girls making our products.
They're not all girls.
No, they're not all girls. No, so it's better. It'd be even more profitable for you if you were to like lay down $1,000 in like or five whatever and. Yeah. Buy your own copies of them and then sell them on the street because then yeah. you would be making more like 30% of what you paid for. I mean, like 60% of what you paid for it
yeah.
or something like that.
And I'd be able to buy more books and still be able to eat food and go sleep in a car instead of a house.
Okay, I don't know how old you are. You don't have to tell us how old you are. But I'll tell you what. Do you remember this thing called poetry.com?
I've heard of it, yeah.
Okay, well, there was this thing called poetry.com, and you can pay. This is, I don't know, man. This is like almost 10 years ago. And you can pay to have your poem published in this book. And this was on the internet. Uh-huh. Poetry.com. You can go to their website, and your poem gets published on the internet, on the website. And this is, you know, the things change fast on the internet. And 10 years ago, that's like 100 years ago. Like,
yeah.
In internet years, you know? Okay. So 10 years ago, getting your poem published online by somebody that was not you, that was not your own blog or whatever, was a big deal. And you're like, you're telling people, hey, yeah, I'm published. I'm telling people, like, I'm published on poetry.com. Just check out my poems. You can go look at my poems, you know? So you can submit your poem to poetry.com, and they would publish you in a book.
Yeah.
But every person in that book had to pay, like, $55. And you would get a copy of the book. And the book was, like, this thick. It was, like, 2 inches, 3 inches thick, something like that, maybe. And then they would mail it to you, and just think about all the money they made because...
Yeah, because it's...
Every page had three or four poems on it.
What's going
maybe
on?
Maybe more.
What's going on is, and this always happens, before the internet, before, like, now, even now, it's kind of like when you see the vintage gold coins, the collector's items, and they're saying, like, they're the dollar gold coins, the Sacagawea or whatever, and they're like, yeah, it's $35 for this. You're spending $35 for a dollar coin. Like, that's real simple mathematics.
Yeah.
You're spending $34 more on a coin. It's not going to cost anymore. If you bust it out, it's still just a dollar.
So what is up with it? Just
it's
because,
the same.
Is it because it's going to be worth something in 20 years?
No, it's just...
Suckers.
People...
Coin collectors.
Oh, yeah.
Y'all need to get a life.
So... It's not even real gold. No, it's no, like the same aspect with the books. Like some people just want to just be published and be immortalized in such a way that they would be willing to pay for the immortalization. I don't really care. Like, well, I care if my books sell, but I don't really care as long as I have people reading my book.
Yeah, well, that was what I liked. It was neat to me to see my print, the thing, something I wrote and published, it went to this factory and these people published it.
Oh, so you did this?
Yeah, I did it. And I lost the book. I don't know what happened. Because one day I realized this is retarded.
Yeah.
Like what I did for this this poetry.com, I was like being swindled.
Well, and it's like they give you, it's like they're using their
rights.
But they're using your rights. In a fashion like where they're you're paying them to do this, but to publish and do all this stuff and everything and put in there, but they're also using your rights because they're making money off of this essentially by giving you a book. You paid for the book, really. You didn't pay for your poem to be into the book. It's a scam for you to buy their book so they can make money, and that's probably where the legality is, the loophole there. So they're like, oh, we weren't using their rights at all. They're buying a book from us, and we're just putting their story in there. And that's probably how they did that.
Yeah. Pretty soon after when I got my book, I realized that as I got smarter in life, I realized that the only girls that I could impress with that book were girls from in a trailer park or, like, girls that just got here from Mexico. Because that's, you know, I'm gonna try to impress women with my poetry, of course.
Yeah.
Right. Who's not gonna try to do that?
Well, see, like I do try and impress women with my poetry, but this is how I do it. I don't pull out a book. I kind of like, would you like me to write you a poem? And then I'll just write it on the spot.
Yeah.
But that's really hard. So, like that woman has to be like some sort of special to me for me to do that.
Yeah. Yeah, you would have to feel it. You'd have to gain some sort of inspiration. She'd have to be a Matilda. Matilda's Pablo Neruda's wife.
Okay, yeah.
He loved her very much.
Yeah.
So I was saying that, you know, just to illustrate how I came to... I was kind of joking about the ladies thing. But it's true now that I think about it. Now that I think about it, that not very many people would be impressed. But it's still great to see your work in print. and to see it as something tangible that people can, you can give it to them, and you could pick it up and read it yourself.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and that is a really powerful and rewarding and, you know, it's just powerful. It's a powerful thing to have, you know.
Well, the cool thing about it is it's actually realigned my life in such a way as a performer, as a writer, as a, you know, to where I'm more interactive with the fans or the people that really like my writing and like that, to the point where like I'm like, I've made some mistakes and I need to go ahead and like rectify them and make sure that like I'm nice, because I did a Kickstarter for the first book.
Mm-hmm.
And I even put it in the Kickstarter that this is probably, I found out this isn't really paying for the book, but this is paying for a travel to the West Coast to help with my book and promote this.
Mm-hmm.
And they had all these rewards, but I'm just this lowly musician that lives in poverty and just enjoys being poor.
Mm-hmm. No. I read somewhere that the stereotype of the starving artist was created by the art and music industry executives. Oh, they like living like that.
Yeah,
they
like it.
Okay, so you did a Kickstarter and then you got, and then you did your book and then wrote it.
Yeah, I got $1,000 or a little less than $1,000 because they take a little bit out. And
because your friends are cheap asses.
No, that was the.
On your Kickstarter.
Well, this is where it gets.
I mean, Amanda Palmer got over $1 million.
Oh, yeah. That's really amazing. I got to meet her and Neil Gaiman last year, too, so from the boat.
Oh, cool.
But no, like,
you should have told her to give you some money.
No.
I'm just messing around.
She gave me a kiss in the cheek, so.
Oh, cool. Yeah.
The problem with, and it's actually, that's funny, because her TED Talk really inspires me, and I watched it recently, and it's like, well, I kind of screwed up, because I haven't really, it's a binding contract between me and the person, and it's not me with Kickstarter. Kickstarter doesn't really enforce anything that happens, so you're kind of going out on a limb and hoping this person's a good person and will go forward through with the rewards. Well, I don't have money to buy books, and then when I do, I sell the books, and then I just didn't get all my rewards out. Now that's what I'm doing right now. I'm scrambling. I'm buying like a whole bunch of books next week just to have them, and then I'm giving them an extra reward, which they might see your videos. I'm not going to mention it on here, but
well, you know, yeah, man, you know, this my favorite book cover that you have, because I'm a minimalist kind of dude, is the one in the middle.
Oh yeah, the black.
Yeah, I like that. I like that writing and the minimalist, like, and it's always been attractive to me, that.
Oh yeah,
like that simplified, and that's the stream of consciousness book.
Yeah,
yeah, that's cool, man. I wouldn't have the courage to publish a stream of consciousness book.
Oh, yeah. There's a chapter in here that's just every other word's fuck.
People, yeah. So, yeah, that's what I was going to say. People would realize that I have Tourette's.
Yeah.
But I don't. I don't really have Tourette's.
It was a, I was having that I did. A really bad day that day, too.
Yeah.
And it's just like a day-by-day basis, 30 days of whatever was on my mind, and I wrote it. Like, there's actually one chapter that's only one line long. Because I could, and
that's another great thing about self-publishing.
Yeah, if I find it, I think I passed it. I kind of want to read it because, all right, I lied. It's not one line long, but I like one line in it. It says, "I do not need. I do not want. I own it all. Every speck of matter is mine. Mine to destroy. Mine to give up. Mine to please. For I am the true avarice of this world."
The true avarice?
Yeah.
What is an avarice?
It's greed. Like, avarice is greed. Like, you know, envy is to jealousy, avarice is to greed. Yeah. And that's just like a moment when I'm like, I can do anything I ever want. And I could just, like, I can just do whatever I want and be crazy or be sad or happy or angry, and it's okay.
So it's like a liberating moment. It was a liberating moment.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, it was just like this, and at the same time, it was like a joke, because really how I feel is like all of us can do anything we want, and some of us do, like, do anything we want, like, or it's more like some people pursue engineering or being like a doctor or a scientist because that's what they really want to do, and they pursue it, they get into it and everything. Now, the funny, this is the inside funniness to that, to me, is that they really enjoy musicians and they would like to be a musician, but they've so focused their minds on this one pursuit that they can't, because they're continuing to focus on this and they just don't have time. And that's like the underlying joke, the universal joke is you have time for only the one thing. And I do a lot of things. Yeah. So it's like, I kind of don't understand, like, somehow I make time. Mm-hmm. Like, there's like 27 to 36 hours in a day for me. I don't know how I do it, but it happens.
Yeah.
Like, it's just crazy.
Yeah, that's great, man. That's very important what you're talking about people, in a sense, like, limiting themselves or not, or maybe it's just natural that you go into a field and then your mind is just made up of that stuff.
Yeah.
And then you just can't see things any another way.
But it's good too. Yeah. It's like to focus on that. Like for me, I realized that's happened to me recently where I'm just music and art and writing and dance and like all this, like, and performance and technical, like theater, technical work. And, I don't understand a lot of things that, like, people will say something and I'm like, what's that? And they're like, you don't know what that is? So someone will see a show, like, I don't know what that is, because I don't watch a lot of TV. I'll watch movies, yeah, but I just don't, like, go, and I don't go online a lot, because I don't use, like, I use Twitter and Instagram, because it's just nice to throw out there a little bit, just to, like, write whatever from time to time.
You know, what you're describing is I feel that way inversed, in the sense that I there's all this stuff that I study and stuff that I know things about that I can virtually talk to almost like nobody about. But which means like four or five people, and two of them have kids and two of them work in the day and one of them works at night and et cetera, et cetera. And they're not available.
Yeah.
You know, and, yeah, but there, like, things like or discussing people like Jacob Applebaum, who's a hacker slash, you know, program writer, and Julian Assange or Edward Snowden or things like that, you know, or even somebody as popular as Noam Chomsky. You'd be amazed at how many people don't know who that is.
Yeah.
If you're talking about politics or if you're interested in just other things, just people who are interested in learning about biology or hearing a biologist talk about something.
Yeah.
You know,
well, it's kind of like, it's almost like trivia, but what's trivia for us or for me or for you? It's like, I can do music trivia. Like, you can ask me what small instrument has 8 strings on it. That's a mandolin. But a lot of people would like, what? I don't know. You know, it's like, to me, it's not trivial because it's something that I use or work with.
What's one of the things that you pay attention to and study, like, or that you're a fan of in your life that there's not that many people that are a fan? They're not a fan of it.
I study compositions. Like, I really work in composition a lot, and I actually compose myself, and I work with... There are still a lot of people that are interested in that, but there's not, like... I mean, I keep compositions on me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that I've written, but I like just to look at it and study, like, okay, I could do this and this.
Yeah.
And then really understand it. And music is a second language.
Yeah, so composition is neat, man, because it opens you up musically. You see music and you see new things.
Yeah.
And music, and, like anything, like changing instruments, you'll see new things.
And then you, like, when you work on it and you start writing, you're like, oh, okay, because there's
you start visualizing it, too. Yeah. It helps, too.
There's a piece that I wrote all in B major on the piano. It's, like, 30 minutes long, but I'm still working it out. And it wasn't originally, it's not... Like, on the piano, it's all the black keys, really. Mm-hmm. And that's why it's in B major, because mm-hmm. it's all in black keys. Mm-hmm. And so when I'm writing it, it would be easy because it just put B major, done. And just it'd be the easiest thing ever. But it's so like interesting because the tonics aren't B at all because it doesn't use white keys.
Yeah.
So it kind of brings out this more floral incandescent.
So
feel.
It's pentatonic. If you're only using the black keys, it's pentatonic.
Yeah.
You know, and you could when you're playing in pentatonic, you run the risk of your music sounding Asian, like Chinese.
Yeah.
If you don't intend it to sound that way, it can sound that way. So it's really interesting trying to play something pentatonic where you can make it jazzy or classical.
Yeah.
Or something like that, because you can make Asian sounds on the notes pretty easily.
Yeah.
You know, with a black keys. You know, does the piece that you're working on the B&B,
it'll have that? Some Asian that Eastern descent, like, you mm-hmm. know, and then sometimes it won't. It'll sound very like grotesque and cathedral-like and medieval-like. That's
so. If you don't mind, I want to ask you about books that you read, or a book that you've read, or writers that you like. Uh-huh. Like, who? I'm curious because that's still stuck in my mind from when we were talking about it.
It's fine. I guess like back when I was younger, I really liked Edgar Allan Poe. Oh, I know Douglas Adams. I love Douglas Adams,
who's the
Hitchhiker's
Guide to the Galaxy,
which in my new book I made a reference to. yeah. And then I like playwrights. I like a lot of playwrights. Like, I'm a fan of Shakespeare. I like a huge fan of Shakespeare and mm-hmm. how. Like, and not just from the play aspect, but from the writing styles.
Yeah, his writing is amazing, man. The meter and word, it's really written to be spoken.
Because that's the biggest thing. Because when I write, I write something out, then I read it out loud, and if it doesn't have its rhythm to it, then there's something wrong. And it's so strange to me, but like that's what I love about Shakespeare is it's just he also makes things up. Like, I'm sure there's plenty of words.
You mean the
like,
words?
Yeah.
Like, I love that, dude. People need to make more words up.
Yeah, I think it's
what
great.
What is up with that? People don't do that anymore. There's a pseudo dictionary on the internet. I'm on there. I make words. I've made several words up.
Yeah.
And but it shows a lot of freedom and creativity to invent words and to, when I'm speaking, even if I'm doing a podcast or something, if I add a idity to the end of the word or ism to the end of the word that doesn't have one of those. Like charisma isn't.
Yeah.
Like, it's like, you know what I mean.
You know,
it's just poetry like that. It's poetic license.
And there's Neil Gaiman. I do enjoy Neil mm-hmm. Gaiman's works. But
Neil Gaiman, what did he write?
He wrote, there's like a graphic novel, Sandman comic. There's Coraline. I don't want to try to name them all. American Gods is one thing, like a newer thing he wrote. He also did
I heard Coraline was really dark, like the real actual book.
Yeah.
Like darker than the movie. Like
he's just an incredible writer when it comes down to
He's British, right? Neil Gaiman?
Yeah.
Okay, and he reminds me of, he must hang out with Terry Gilliam or something.
Oh, Terry Gilliam's cool.
Yeah.
He's been doing it for some time now, and
they must smoke weed together or something.
I don't know. Probably, or just hang out.
They must have brandies together.
Neil Gaiman is Amanda Palmer's husband.
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah. So,
wow.
Yeah, I met him, and it was like this big thing because I look up to them in different ways, and so I was like, this is so cool. But no, he did a couple of the screenplays for Doctor Who. He like was guest writer or he just actually wrote a couple of the Doctor Who. So mm-hmm. that's the top of BBC TV show, which is was really cool. And I really like his take on things a lot. There's a couple other ones I can't remember that he's like. I started.
So you have, but you
books.
Haven't read anything in a while. Like, you haven't been reading very much. You've been writing, composing.
I read last year on the boat because it didn't. Boat sways. It's hard to write longhand when it sways.
Yeah.
So it's like you tend to read a lot more. But, and like, my friend did have one of Neil Gaiman's books there, and I read some of it. And it was like,
Did he have a wooden leg, your friend?
No, he was actually another...
Was he missing an arm and he had a hook on the end?
No, he's one of the other. He's one of the crew that came from Jacksonville. So okay. It's like there was two of us from Jacksonville, and he was one of them, Ronnie. And he's an engineer. So he
Did
was
anybody on the boat have a wooden leg?
No. Might have had a wooden toe, but I didn't see it. A wooden toe.
I wanted to be a pirate ship, damn it. There's something so fascinating about seafaring. And seafarers, you know, it's already fascinating right now. But when I read about it, because I like reading about it, apparently I didn't realize that I did, is when I read about it from like times, let's say 1800s or the 1700s, but let's say the 1800s, and there's no radar and there's no beacon signal. And when you go, you go.
Yeah.
You go out into the middle of the ocean. You are in the middle of the ocean by yourself, no Coast Guard. Nothing, you know, no navigation system except your compass or whatever you have. It's not electronic. It's just like, wow.
Your sextant. You got to have your sextant.
Yeah, I mean, it's kind of like laughing in the face of death to me because there's so, who knows what can happen out there. You're going to cross the sea. You're going to be out to sea. We're going to be out to sea for 3 months or 6 months or whatever. And your people start starving to death and getting scurvy and like eating limes, trying to eat limes or prevent that.
Yeah.
Mutiny happens on ships and giant squids and octopuses and white squalls. You know, all this stuff that could possibly happen.
Careful of the mermaids.
Right, and the mermaids. And you're a seafarer, shoals. You're a seafarer and you know all of this and you still go.
Yeah.
That is some serious balls.
That's like, that's kind of how it was there. Like, we went through a couple of storms and those were heavy. And like, 10-foot swells dropping over the boat. I was smiling. I was like, this is so much fun.
I would have been, Donovan is fucking crazy. I would have been smiling.
Get everyone into life vests, and you're like, they're all like, a couple people are freaking out. A couple people aren't. You could tell who's who in that situation.
I'd be hanging out near the top of the ship.
Oh, man. Like,
just ready to go.
Whoever was on watch had to be like, or whoever wasn't on watch had to be below deck. And who was on watch had to be above deck. And we had a girl that was on watch. There's this guy up bow watch, which they had to sit in the very front of the boat and make sure there's nothing, because it's a 90-foot boat, so you can't really see what's up past the mast and everything. You need that person. So they...
I'm picturing her. Keep going.
Yeah, this storm hits, and she freaks out and leaves him at the front of the boat. And he can't leave, and so she runs all the way back, and she's freaking out. She came to the navigation station where I was. She's freaking out. I was like, calm down, it's cool. And I was like, we're all going to get through this. Like, I kind of, like, calmed her down, and I was like, just go downstairs, like, go down to the salon, and it'll be fine. And then there, like, I look up, and there's the helmsman is doing a good job, and it's just like, the captain's yelling, just so, because you gotta, it's so loud.
They all sound like pirates to me, in my imagination, right? Tell me.
It's okay, it's so loud there.
Rain down before day.
They look like pirates at that time, like, because there's just raining.
Their hats blowing sideways.
And there was a water funnel.
I love it.
One of those tornadoes that were like just off the stern. Man. And it was crazy.
And they keep going out to sea.
Yeah.
Just asking for it.
Nah. No,
death wish. Laughing in the face of death. That's what seafaring is.
This wasn't seafaring. This is intercoastal work. Like, we were in the...
you guys were in the bathtub?
We were in the pool. We're in the Chesapeake Bay. But actually, no, it's more dangerous. Storms are a lot more dangerous closer inland like that.
Oh, really?
Because you don't... In the ocean,
you could hit a rock or something.
Well, not only that, in the ocean, if you see a storm, you can avoid it. In like closer to land, if a storm hits, storm can hit without you knowing about it, and just it's there. And like, oh well, you're screwed. You gotta have to kind of deal with it at the time. Like, there's not enough reports that are like factual that come in. Even if you have all the technology, you can't. There's no way of knowing. Yeah. And this storm kind of hit us. Like, out of nowhere. Like, we saw clouds, and we're like, oh, okay. And the captain had to make a decision of what we should do, if we should keep pushing forward.
I call it bullshit. Somebody on that boat was incompetent. They didn't know how to look for a storm. red skies at night, sailors and shepherds take sailors' delight. Red skies at morning, sailors and shepherds take warning. He didn't listen to that.
Well, it was in the middle of the day.
I'm just theorizing over here.
And it's also watches change. Like, we have three watches, so it's 4 hours on, 8 hours off.
Somebody was sleeping on this watch. So yeah, man, that's my worst nightmare. One of my worst nightmares right there. Being in a con in the middle of a storm.
It was so much fun. Like,
oh, it was fun to you.
Yeah. I was like, I was having a blast. Like,
that's fun.
Yeah, a lot of people were terrified though.
Yeah, what do you do on the weekends? I stick my head in the shark mounds. It's fun.
I used to play with a wolf, a little wild wolf too. Go out.
A wolf.
Like a wolf. Yeah, my friend had a wolf that she, I don't know how she got it, but it was like a nice large wolf, and it's like, it seems like this real tall.
Yeah.
I'd stick my whole arm in its mouth and just play with it.
Man, I saw a guy playing with a tiger like it was a cat.
Yeah.
Like a full-grown tiger, and the cat was just knocking him over.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, I would never do that shit. I'm just too cautious. Maybe I don't know what it is.
Well, some people can't
white enough,
do it,
bro.
And
that's what it is.
That guy's because, too rich. He
because you know, you know, not to bring race into this and all that kind of stuff, but like culturally, like, you know, skydiving and bungee jumping,
I wouldn't do either of those,
and the roller coasters and the finger fairies. You know what I mean? And what is the other one called where you glide down the side of the mountain? Base jumping.
Oh, that's
all these kinds gliding of things. Yeah, it's just not. You don't really see like Mexicans and like, you know, African Americans like doing that.
Oh, well, some of the Mexicans are the ones that got me into playing with wolves and things like that. And then there's like a.
They were mixed, bro. No, but seriously, it's just like. I don't know. I've never been like that. I never really liked roller coasters that much.
I don't like roller coasters, you know, at all.
So wait a minute. Where are we going right now? Because I want to talk about your books. I want to talk about your books a little bit more.
Okay.
But I love talking about seafaring, actually. I hate to interrupt that.
No, that's fine.
And
we kind of jumped off the cliff just there.
Yeah, that's cool. There's no problem with that.
Yeah.
And so people can buy these books on the internet.
Yeah, Amazon.com.
Amazon.com. And maybe I'll publish a book. Yeah. Like, I would like to publish a book. And, you know, do you encourage people to go through this process, or do you encourage them to buy their own books if they can and then do it that way?
Either both ways. Don't. It's kind of like when you, when you're making music. You have a CD, but you also have a live show. Do you want people to come to your live show, or do you want them to come buy a CD? It's a similar way of asking it. So it's like you want them to do both. You want them to come at the live show, but you also want them to enjoy your music at home. So either one you can do if you like the aspect of... Because also I do Kindle, so people can buy my book or... buy the little thing on Kindle and then be able to read it on your little tablet, which probably does hurt your eyes somehow, but they say it doesn't. So
yeah.
I prefer paper to computer screen. Just
what is this a battle? Is this a real battle between people like the paper people of and the Kindle people? And the people are like, I just like the feel of a good book. I like the feel of a real book. And then you have the other people who are... What is the other person's argument there? Convenience?
The only thing I'll say is I can't sign a Kindle.
Sure you can. But it's like costs a lot of money per Kindle. That's the key, bro. The key. Kindle, signed Kindle covers.
Oh, now they're going to see this and they're like, oh, we got this.
What? No, that's a good idea. Yeah. It's fine. They can know that.
Yeah,
signed Kindle covers. Or you can make... custom signature Kindle cases.
Yeah.
Or something like that. I'm just brainstorming here.
Oh, yeah.
You know, it's a pretty good idea, like signed Kindle covers. But so you like books better. I like books better too, except when I'm going to sleep.
Well,
I'm reading in the complete dark.
I also heard, well, that's true. It's good to have a Kindle and so you can read in light and kind of fall asleep with it. Like, I like, I'll sleep if I'm reading something, because I've heard people will read with their book up above them. I can't read like that. It's like my arms get tired.
Well, yeah, after like 15 minutes, the blood's going to be rushing from your fingertips down. It's not going to be going up there.
It's just going to, so I'd read on my side, you know, and then, or read on my belly, which turn when I finally fall asleep, I'll just roll over and I don't have to worry about it.
I hold the Kindle like an L.
Oh, like an L.
I just put it, I stick it right here in the web of my thumb.
Okay.
And my index finger. And I just hold it in there and I just hold it up like that. But I get tired and then I use the other hand.
Yeah.
You know, and it does. It's fatiguing.
Yeah.
You know, but so is the book. The book is fatiguing too because I have to hold it open. Or if you get some sort of device, you can hold it open with something.
Like a music stand device.
Yeah. Actually, I saw this thing that you put over your thumb.
Oh, yeah.
It looks like the propeller to an old airplane.
Really?
Yeah, with a hole in it and you put it into your thumb. And it sticks out and it makes a T across your thumb. And then you're holding the pages like this. It's holding the pages down on both sides. Because you have your fingers behind the book and you have your thumb in front of the book. And your thumb's holding the pages together. I mean, it's holding it down like a plancha in Spanish. Se dice. But so I like the Kindle book at nighttime when I'm reading. I like the real book because I like to jump around when I read, you know, and it's not very easy to jump around on a Kindle when you're reading.
Yeah.
You know, like I like to look at, like, let me just go to page, what was that thing that happened at page 96? And I'm on page 205, right? On a Kindle, I don't even want to do that because I'm going to have to go like, I have to like move this button, you know, the fake button and. You know, they have their pros and their cons, but...
Don't they have, like, you can flip 10 or 100 pages or something like that?
I don't know. Whatever the fuck it is, it's like, it's not as simple as me just flipping the pages. You know, I don't know how to do it.
Yeah.
So, the thing is, it's kind of sad. The Kindle's kind of sad to me because the art of the book is it's an art form. And the binding of the book and the print of the book and the quality of the paper and... the cover of the book and color and the fact that it's just a tangible object and you could throw it at somebody, you know,
it's like there's one thing I like about papers, and this is kind of something I want to do is, I want to write an epic book, like just large and, which might end up being like a whole bunch of my little books stacked into one. And then I want to like learn how to bind it myself. So, like, do the printing and everything. Just one or 10 books. Just do 10 books by myself. Mm-hmm. And then, bind it and everything. And then have these books. And be like, yeah, I did this myself. It's just a throwaway of, like, going all the way through it. And it's kind of like wanting to be in a traditional publisher. Which I want to do. But at the same time... I realize it really doesn't matter. All they'll do is make my job easier in marketing. That's it. Like, but
So there's marketing is a thing right now. For example, as a musician, you have to be, if you're going to be like a soloist and you're going to be independent, you have to be the musician and you have to be the marketer and you have to be the graphic designer and you have to be the web designer and you have to be the social media person and you have to be the person who practices the guitar or whatever you play, you know, and you have to be the recording engineer. And that's just this bullshit. It's such a mess. So. It's like, you know, but the positive side of the way that the media is right now is that everybody has access. You have access to all the same people that Penguin Books has access to.
Yeah.
However, we have this phenomenon on social media that's been pretty popular lately where people have these gated communities, these closed off communities, where it's actually antithetical to an open web to where, let's say if you're on a social media site where it's your friends and your community only, well, tough shit because it's not going to get out of there.
Yeah.
And on top of that, your friends and your community don't share your work.
Yeah.
I don't know if you noticed this or not. But people don't respect your work until strangers respect your work.
Yeah, that's...
You know, your family and your friends, they're like... You know, your family may be supportive and whatnot, but your peers, they don't.
And I've actually been getting out like that, because I use, like, talking with people, I use that more than I use social media. Like, I use social media just to see, oh, okay,
yeah, this person's doing this. Yeah, you know, dude, that's a cultural thing, too.
Yeah.
Because it's not like that, like, growing up in Chicano, L.A., you actually, there's other things where people are, like, haters about to each other, but you definitely help each other with certain things like that.
Yeah, like, I don't, it's kind of like the same as, and I was talking to a friend the other day about this, is I don't like looking for women online. It just makes, I tried it out. It's just like, it's the same of trying to push my books online. I'm like, well, this is kind of just, you know, whatever. But there's more of a personal thing going on when it's like in person and you're moving it and you're like, oh, go to Chamblin's, go to this bookstore. Like, oh, I'm getting some bookstores up in New York. They're going to be holding my book. Tell all my friends about it so they can go into the bookstore and actually see my physical book, and it creates an emotion. Mm-hmm. Whereas when you see it on the screen, it's so quick. It's like a few minutes. You're not doing something. You're not actually going out there and experiencing and having an adventure. And it's creating, that's what I feel like going to a bookstore in a place that you're not used to. Mm-hmm. First off, creates a whole new experience, and it's a whole new adventure. And I think,
yeah, man, I miss that too. See, the bookstores are dwindling.
Yeah,
and Barnes and Noble. I know it's a chain, but Barnes and Noble closed down a couple of locations here in Jacksonville, and then Borders, which was my spot, closed down. And then I was very thankful for Chamblin's moving downtown and serving coffee and having a coffee shop, because I like that experience.
Yeah,
you go, and then at Chamblin's, on top of that, you can order like a Corona. Yeah. And walk around the store drinking a Corona, like looking for books.
Like in your home, like in your library or something.
You know, but it's great that it's not. It's great that it's not your house. You're out in public and you're amongst people. It's got a social aspect to it.
There's a bookstore in Hudson, New York called The Spotty Dog. And they have a bar in the bookstore. It's just one whole room. And we were in there on the boat, and it was just amazing. Like, I actually got to write there. Like, I did some writing there. I was just like, this is such a fun atmosphere. And so, and that's actually the same place that I met Amanda and Neil. And I was like, this is so cool. Like, everything, like, to me, like, seeing that. But the thing was that town was just that one street. There was just one street, and it was all, everything was on that street. And then, that was it. Like, the rest was like residential, and you know, it was just really interesting and surreal. And that's the same thing. It's like, you've got these like couple bookstores, but it's so surreal because there's like this little, this light in the darkness, and you're just like, oh, okay, cool. But it's dark everywhere else. Like, you know, and
yeah, man. And I don't know how people, I don't know what we're going to do if we lose all the bookstores. I don't think they'll go completely. Mm-hmm. But if you're to honor what our culture is constructed of right now, if you're to honor efficiency, mm-hmm. because that's one of the big like three of our culture, like what we're all about, efficiency, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know why it's so important. It's like that important to get from A to B in such amount of time, and not, instead of more like, what is the point of going from A to B? Asking that question instead.
Yeah.
Or maybe it's not such a good idea to get from A to B and so quickly, but because you can, you're supposed to, right? So things are being digitized more and more.
Well, efficiency also, like, turn down the food markets and everything like that. There's a whole thing, aspect of efficiency that will probably, like, ultimately destroy the arts, because there's no efficiency in the arts, but the whole aspect, like, that would be the one thing. It's kind of like a putting poison in our food to make it last longer so it's more mm-hmm. efficient, but it's poison.
Yeah.
I mean, like, it's the same aspect. You're going, like, they're becoming more efficient by getting rid of things and making it more like you can get it online and everything. Losing that experience, you lose the experience, you lose the experiences of children that want to aspire, that may want to aspire to be an artist. And the arts bring about entertainment, which is something that people need to be more efficient, and mm-hmm. that's the underline, is they want to take out, it seems like that the efficiency is taking out the portion that's going to make it more efficient. Like, it's not.
Yeah. We're so culturally, we're so dumb with our smarts.
Yeah.
In so many ways. You know, and when I look at it, when you really look at it, and things are coming to light right now. I was writing a song / poem the other day. And sometimes I try to address issues that are not very poetic. Mm-hmm. And sometimes they seem to work, and other times they don't. And, I was noticing how I'm sure many other people have noticed is that so much of that we've invented here in the Western world is bad for you. Like, it's coming to light that sidewalks are bad for you, that it's good for you to walk on uneven ground.
Yeah.
It's coming to light that shoes are bad for you with padding on them, that it's better for you to walk something as close as possible to being barefoot, you know, unless you're going to hurt your feet.
Yeah.
Like if you're walking over rocks or glass or stone and you're at work, some steel work, whatever. It's come to light that the processed food, like you mentioned, that makes food last longer on the shelf and is good for capitalism, is good for profits, and it's good for hunger, is bad for you.
Yeah.
You know, it's coming to light that certain kinds of light are bad for you. It's coming to light that microwaving, which is fast, is bad for you. You know, there's so many things. Sitting at a desk all day is bad for you. When that was the thing that you wanted to achieve, achieving a steak every dinner because you're that wealthy is bad for you.
Yeah.
Which, that was the goal, right? That was the goal. I want steak and potatoes and... You know, so all of these goals that we've had have turned out to be two-fisted tails. They've turned out to have a jack-o'-lantern inside of it. I mean, like, yeah. Jack-o'-lantern, a jack-in-the-box.
Yeah.
Like a joke, you know. And, it's just amazing. The list of things that you can get rid of and are actually good for you is enormous.
Yeah.
And the things to keep that we've come up with is tiny.
Yeah.
You know, modern things that, like, running water and, like, wind energy and solar energy and all these kinds of things, these are good. You know, they're better than all this other stuff that I've been mentioning.
I was actually talking to my friend last night about energy. Is it nuclear energy? Is it something that he really wanted me to watch, and he didn't know how I felt about, because I like engineering and energy and all like that. And it's just funny to me because solar energy and wind energy and water, hydrogen energy is like, a lot of people are like, oh, solar energy was like, well, solar energy has a higher frequency for radiation than nuclear energy, only because the safety aspects. There's like so much safety that has been researched and been put into nuclear energy because a lot of people are afraid of it. To the point where, like, it's the radiation from a nuclear power plant will not harm anyone. It's the fallout that if a nuclear power plant explodes and there's a fallout, that's what's going to harm you. But that probably will not happen because there's so many security and safety things put in place to make it where that doesn't really happen. If they see it happening, they close it down, calm everything down, that's good. Whereas solar energy, they think it's good because it's renewable energy, because the sun's constantly putting out solar rays. And yeah, it is good because the renewable energy and that aspect of it's more efficient.
Mm-hmm.
But it's reflecting radiation into our atmosphere, and because
is that real? Is that legit?
That's a real thing. Like, because there are the schematics of how the solar panels sit. They move compared to where the sun is, and because they move at a certain angle, and where the sun is refracting at a separate angle, like a mirror,
mm-hmm.
and we don't see it, so it's not real, and it's like not something like there's all these stipulations. Oh, it's safe because the sun is like, aha, the sun is a
on
giant.
The interwebs today, I saw a new solar panel that is transparent.
Now those may work. They
a
also
transparent solar panel.
They also they
so
also,
it could be all the windows now.
Yeah, there's a way to to absorb all the radiation, because it's what how we're getting the energy from solar is we're absorbing solar radiation.
Mm-hmm.
That's really what it is.
Okay, see, I thought it was heat based. I don't know. I don't mess around with that stuff.
The solar radiation, and then what the radiation that they don't use, they throw back into it, and that's the heat. It's really most of the heat radiation is thrown back into the sky, and that's what's doing this all this stuff. But there's ways around it. But they're coming up with new ways. So they're doing solar dishes, where they're like satellite dishes but solar. And then
so all this thermal. Is being done to sustain the way of life that we have going on already.
Yeah, or to create more energy, to create it where we actually can, because we still can't sustain life that we have regardless. Like, you can't constantly be grasping energy like that.
So what is the goal? What is the solution, do you think? Like, some of us should move underground and be like more hippie-like and live in mounds and like hobbit homes. I'm down with it. I like the idea.
Well, no.
You know, we're pretty minimalist in this household as it is.
Well, you know? It's...
And I know people who are even more minimalist.
Minimalist, like a minimalist ideal is really good. Understanding the key components of how to keep your body running. Like,
so how do we get so crazy with this capitalism, right? Right? It's capitalism.
Well, it's because... Well, I think that's from because of the Great Depression.
I know people who are staunch capitalists.
Yeah. Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
It's the Great Depression, actually.
I love how they get all red in the face when I start talking crap about capitalism. Well, you go live over there, Goliath. You go live over there in China and see what it's like.
Nah, it's more of a... that's like... I don't know. So
we got to this point where all the technology that we're using and what we're doing it with is to support a lifestyle. We can sit and figure it out and put it down on paper and figure out how it happened and how it came to be.
Yeah.
And it matters to a degree. It's kind of entertaining to a degree. But it doesn't really matter for a solution.
Yeah.
Because you could just deal with what you have happening right now and then just work on that, going in a direction that you want to go into instead of, well, how did we get here and what happened and whose fault is it? You know, it would be good for somebody to know that so you don't do that again.
Yeah.
But if you're conscious and you're connected with other people and you have a situation like what we have going on right now with communications, then you can just always stick with the facts of what's happening and new information that you're gathering as you're learning in the direction that you want to go, you know. And yeah, so we're learning a lot of things that we're learning are antithetical to the things that we've been investing ourselves with into for so long, you know. And that we should be okay with that. We should embrace that.
Yeah, well,
especially people here in the South who are over 50 and watch Fox News. They should embrace that. Like, I could be talking about you or your parents, folks. Or your grandparents. You gotta be the change.
So serious.
It won't be. I'm gonna have some silly music in the background.
Oh, okay.
No, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to get all
No, you're good.
Okay,
good. This is fine. Like
So we're running out of time.
Oh, well.
In case you want to talk about something, we need to talk about what you want to talk about.
Also, I want to show this one so they have it. Right?
Mr. Donovan P. King at Amazon.com. All right, very good.
Yeah, I just. Well, then.
That works.
But yeah, from a pad I got in a hotel last week.
As long as this pen doesn't have a little chain on it.
Yeah.
At the end right here. I was working as a waiter at a restaurant.
Oh, that's from another place.
Oh.
Someone gave me that pen.
City.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was working at a restaurant and this businesswoman walks up and she ordered like two desserts.
Yeah.
And I prepared her desserts to go. I put them in a bag and I gave her her bill. And she whips out her pen, and the pen has a
chain
on it, like from a bank, like she stole it from a bank, and I pointed out the chain, and she goes, "Don't ask."
And I was just, like, okay. You just call her a bank robber. You're a bank robber.
And she robbed the pen from the bank.
Robbed the pen of yeah.
So do you have anything else you want to say about life or anything else? I'm pretty sure that, look, when you listen to or watch this, mm-hmm. you're going to be like, damn, I want to talk about this, and damn, I want to talk about that, and damn, I want to this happens to me, it happens to everybody.
Well, I'm getting...
But we can do it again.
Oh, okay.
We can do it again, so...
Well, I'm getting books, and I want to... I'm currently planning a book tour that goes up the East Coast, across Canada, down the West Coast, and back to Jacksonville. Mm-hmm. And that's... I want to try to write while I'm on the book tour, which might be a trick because I want to go by train. Mm-hmm. However, I have no idea how I'm going to finance this trip whatsoever or anything. I just know I'm going to have these books. And the...
Three books. Who writes three books so far?
Yeah.
None of you.
And then, was it... I might need a personal assistant. That's like where I'm starting to really think about it. Like, I just found out my credit was good enough, so I got a credit card so I can buy these books, and now I'm going to
Cool, man.
Bad credit
again. You're going to do that? Okay.
Yeah.
You can do it. Hey, everybody's doing it.
And then...
I should be commended, though, because I have no credit and I have zero debt.
Yeah, it's...
Who else do you know that is, like, in their early 40s and has no credit and zero debt? You know, people criticize me for that, man. I should get an award. I should be on Oprah. Like, I should be, I don't know. They should make a stamp out of me or something.
Yeah, I mean, that's like, that's I don't know. That's one of those small things that like makes people unique. Like you're unique in mm-hmm. that way. Cause I mean,
I think so too. Yeah. And I didn't, that's one of those things that I didn't even try to be that way. I was just like, yeah. Oh, I'm going to do this. This makes sense. I don't want to be like this.
Yeah. You
know? Like, there's something about me, dude, that is, I'm really about what I'm about. Like, I really try to be about what I'm about.
Yeah.
You know, and of course, I have things, my hypocrisies, and I try to get rid of them wherever I can.
Yeah.
You know, but you can't. Nobody's perfect. You can't. So you have to, like, never let perfection get in the way of you moving in the right direction.
Yeah.
You know, that's for sure. So you know, before we go... if you could be, oh wait, you already told me about the books that you've read and stuff, but is there a writer that you've read that you're like, damn, that is really good, like how did you do that?
Oh, I don't really remember. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think
because wait before, like, you can keep thinking about that, but let me elaborate a little bit on
okay.
that, because I read books. And I read books of people who can tell a story very well. Uh-huh. And then there's the other kind of book writer who's like an Oscar Wilde, who plays with words and they're poetic and they're painting of their pictures with their... They're more like... sometimes they're more like showing off their vocabulary instead of trying to put a picture in your mind. Mm-hmm. And then there's these other books that read like a movie script. And it just paints the picture in your mind very well. And... Those, for some reason, the ones that paint a picture in your mind very well, they're very simple English and they read like a movie script, kind of turned me off a little bit. Like,
yeah.
I don't know why.
That's, to me, that's like, that you have an aspect of, you have a whole dictionary of words you can use. And those, I think the people that write those books want them to be turned into a movie. And
right, that's what it looks like, right?
They're trying to actually work it to that point where, like, okay, this will be picked up, someone will appreciate this, and they'll just pick it up. Yeah. And then there's...
Like, if you can't see this as a movie, you're an idiot, right?
But there's the books like that. Like, for me, I write where I don't... I pressure myself not to write into full and heavy descriptions because, to me... A heavy description would be like telling you how many hair follicles is on a person's head mm-hmm. and completely describing a person from like, so you know that every ounce, because this is what I study and research to.
Yeah. When write. I get done with somebody's descriptiveness on a book, I just start skimming.
Yeah.
Like if it's going on for pages, I'm like, and I'm done with it. I'm like, chocolate, black, blue sky.
It's like, there's for that, it's like you have, okay, when you're describing a person, like what they're wearing and who, what they look like, it should be a couple paragraphs, really, in my idea. And that way, and later on in the book, because of the literary license, you can, like, if something happens to this book, you, like, to this character in the book, you can actually, like, add an extra, description in there that would play into the original description you had. They're like, oh, that's cool. But it's not all described at once. Like, it's kind of like when you meet a person and you don't notice everything about them right away. You notice things over time, and you're creating the description over time throughout the book. And that's how I see it. Like when I write, I don't.
Sometimes you meet people who want to tell you everything at once.
Yeah.
Like, I've been that person at times, but it just depends on what mood I'm in. Hey, yeah, my name's Goliath Flores. I play music and I'm a writer. I got a podcast.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm a podcaster.
Yeah, like,
I got a website, I got a Tumblr.
But at the same time, like, you're not giving everything. You're only giving that. They're professional.
They only caught, like, all they caught was like, that dude is annoying. Oh my God.
So, I don't know. I pick a lot of different attributes from different writers. Like, I like this, I like that. Like,
it's so, for me, and I wonder if it's the same for people who are writers. For me, it is so hard to put into words what somebody else's words are doing to me.
Yeah.
Like, how do you write about writing? Like, writing about writing is just kind of, it's like music theory. Like, you write, you're talking about music theory, music and theory, and like you can music theory yourself all day long and you're not going to move anybody.
Yeah.
You know? But you could be a dude with one string on the guitar and sing, and you're going to move everybody.
Yeah.
You know, and so that is, it's just this mystery that I love about the writing thing. Yeah, I don't think I'm ever going to be a writer. Like, I don't think I'm, maybe I am a writer, who knows? But I don't think I'm ever going to be a dude who has books out and, like, novels. I would like to, there's stories that I would like to tell, but I know just from dabbling in it, the amount of work that it takes. The amount of hours that it takes, like, sitting down and coming up with that.
Yeah, it takes me, sometimes you sit down and you don't write. You just sit there and you look out in the distance in, like, a far-off country and you're just kind of like, what am I going to write today? And then, like, you know, like, I know I'm going to write, but at the same time, like, how am I going to write this? And sometimes I'll contemplate for one sentence. I'll contemplate for a whole hour just to write this one sentence. And it's always like, oh, why do it take so long? But it's just insane. It's crazy.
That's great. That's a train of thought that is not being encouraged by the pace of information.
Yeah.
The way that it's going now. Because I like what you're talking about, there's small thoughts that when I was a kid, I used to spend maybe 48 hours on. And this kind of, who knows what it does to your brain, what kind of grooves it makes in there, so to speak, you know, to do that. And who knows what kind of effects it has to not do that anymore, you know, to always distract yourself with a mobile device or, you know, I'm not saying you do that, but I'm saying other people. You know, and so yeah, I can see how much work it takes to do that. And the name of your next book, do you have a title for your next book?
Unknown Piracy. Or no, wait, sorry. Unofficial Piracy.
Unofficial Piracy?
Yeah.
Unofficial Piracy. And what is it about? Can you tell? Can you say?
It's about this kid, Polio Theodore Stent. And how he learns to aspire, to dream. That's pretty much really what it is, because he doesn't dream or aspire to anything.
Huh.
So he doesn't know what, he's 23 when he starts this adventure, and he just, like, I'm in the fourth chapter now, and I'm just described him, and, like, did all this backstory to, like, help push the book, and
So yeah. Here, check this out. When I have a bunch of writings, like on this computer right here, mm-hmm. even other computers, I have a writing too, right? I have a bunch of writing, and like to slap that together, you have more courage than me to put it all together to like even try to make sense of that all.
Yeah.
It's just like, I don't even know. Like, and now I see why sometimes I see books where people write in teams. Mm-hmm. There's written by such and such and such and such. You've seen that?
Yeah.
Have you seen that? That must be so much easier. You just throw your pile of work on the other person and be like, what do you think about this? Like,
yeah. Here, can yeah. you, like, and like, no, I don't want it this way. It's like, but this is better this way. Like, yeah. No, it's not. Like,
so I always wonder, does a writer who writes novels have a story? Do they have a story already laid out? Like, this is going to happen, and this is going to happen, and this person's going to die, and then this is going to be under this book.
Well, there's outlines, and then I came up with the idea last year after the captain of the boat said, no, I don't want to give you permission to write about your time on the boat. I'm like, okay, cool. And I came up with this idea, and it really started with Polio Theodore Stint. It started with a name. It's like, okay. And then I created the book around the name, and like his father's name is Theodore Frederick Stint, also known as Ted Fred.
Mm-hmm.
And then his mother was known as the woman in red. His mother doesn't have a name. So it's like all these elements, and then starting to bring out, grabbing from experiences. All the poems I did write while I was on the boat, however, are going into the book as like these unknown writings that.
Why did the guy not want to write? What kind of asshole is this? What's his name?
No. He was the captain. He had perfect reason. Someone.
I am the captain of the Pinafore and a mighty good captain too.
What
I'll never say.
What has happened was.
Has he seen the captain of the Pinafore? I'm sorry. It's just I'll shut up.
No, it's
you. What happened was.
What happened was someone had not asked for permission, like a couple writers before me. Because they've been doing this for 40 years. So a couple writers before me had not asked them permission and published a book and used the rights without doing any of this. And they, after, and then I think a couple of them, he told them, please be careful with this because this is like, you know, and then this guy came out and did it. Or he told him no and he did it anyway. So it's like, you know what, that really sucks. Like, because this is their lifeblood and who they are, and they want to do this, and I would promote them every day, all day, because I love the ship and I love the company.
Then the writer was like, "But if it wasn't for me, nobody would even know about you."
No, it's not even that either. Like I mean, the whole purpose of that boat is to go to cities and to bring them something that they wouldn't normally get.
Okay.
And so like bringing them a rock opera to a city of Bivalve, New Jersey. Bivalve is like 5 people population.
Pretty soon that ship's gonna have a live webcam.
It's well, they have a blog and stuff like that. Yeah. Oh, if the captain sees this, he'll be like, "Oh, that's a good idea. let's go and do this."
Yeah. No, he can't have that idea. You can't have that idea unless you let Donovan.
No, let's not do it.
They're gonna have a Wii game of the book. I'm getting stupid now.
That whole happening became a huge inspiration. In fact, it's like no experience is a bad experience, mm-hmm. like for me as a writer, because everything is thrown into a pot to make the soup that more delicious. You know that. So I kind of
that jambalaya.
That's so good. It's
Siete Mares.
Yeah. So
that's a soup. Mexican seafood soup.
Oh, that's
Siete Mares, yeah.
That sounds good.
Yeah, it's called the Seven Seas.
Oh, really?
Because it has, Siete Mares, because it has all the like the seafood in it.
Wow.
It oysters and clams and shrimp and crab legs and lobster and you name it, whatever. It has fish cool. heads and maybe, I don't know. You know, it has everything in there. No fish heads, really.
Fish heads are fine.
Oh, okay, good. Fish heads. People don't like fish heads around here.
I don't know why. There's high nutrition in fish heads.
Yeah.
People are weird.
They are, man.
Like, have the fisheye, that, like, you know, that sliminess going around in your tongue. Yeah.
That was like, that sounds great. That sounds good, dude. I'd be like... we have to go, bro.
All right.
All right, so it was. Thank you very much for coming on the podcast.
Yeah.
And it was excellent. And if you ever want to, you can come back to the podcast. And
cool.
We can do this again. And is there anything else you want to talk about? Anything else you want to say?
No. Just go buy my books on Amazon.com.
All right, cool. Yeah, so like I said, if you ever want to talk about anything else, we can come back and do this again.
Yeah.
And that's it, bro.
Cool. All right. That was cool. That was fun.
Oh, you can hear the music in your imagination. So I have to scream. So that was an hour and a half. It was over an hour and a half. Did you feel like it?
Yeah. Glad you asked me this. Glad you said something about this.
Oh, yeah.
I was like, oh, it's great to write this out.
So what I do now is...